Well, howdy guys and gals, welcome back to the Social Regressive and part 14 in our optics series. My goal here is to help you determine what scope is best for you and your individual situation. Some of the factors that come into this might be personal, some of them might be based on the trajectory of the round that you have. It's really all going to be target centric, so let's keep this in mind as we discuss one particular kind of rifle scope that was probably near and dear to your grandpa's heart. You probably looked through one of these types of scopes and you didn't realize it at the time. But fixed power scopes have some superpowers that some people really tend to forget about. Most of the scopes that you see here on the bench have some kind of zoom going on, and it's going to be one that's variable. So for example, this scope right here is a 4.5 to 18. I can have an image coming through the scope. I can have my target enlarged 4.5 times, or if I zoom all the way in, it'll be 18 times larger than it normally is to my naked eye at this distance. And we have zoom ratios and different zoom factors all over the place here. Some for varminting, some for closer up work. But then you get into some pretty strange scopes that have been with us for a very long time. That is the fixed power scope right here. This is one that has some real benefits that you need to be thinking about before you make your final choice. Depending on what your situation is, this could be perfect for you. If you want to see real reviews of some of the best fixed power scopes out there, I recommend that you go straight to Cyclops Joe Ray, to his channel. He has talked about the powers of this kind of scope quite a bit. It is, I think, his favorite type. Just to hear him talk about it and the smile that lights up on his face, he really likes a good fixed power scope. So yeah, check him out, check his channel out, and please subscribe to him because he comes out with new reviews on awesome scopes all the time. I'm not going into as much detail as he will. He's really the one to defer to when it comes to this topic. I have a couple of fixed power scopes here and I like them a lot. We'll just go through some of the benefits. This is the SWFA SS 12x42. That means that this has a fixed 12 power and a 42mm objective. They have been making scopes like this forever, and they have a variety of fixed powers that you can get. You can get a 6, an 8, I think, a 10, a 12, a 16, and a 20. You can check out their catalog to see what magnifications they have, but all of those models are going to be fixed. Yes, they make some ones that zoom as well, and they are very good, but this is one that has been in their catalog just forever. This used to be an old sniper scope, if I remember right, that was actually used by the military, and then they started producing this, especially for the commercial market, and people still rely on these. There are a lot of precision shooters out there that know that if they have a budget of $300 and they want to get a scope that is going to perform really well with the glass, with the reticle, and is going to track perfectly every single time, they go straight to the SWFA SS. This is one of those hidden gems for people that are in the know on this sort of stuff. And this does work really well. This is the exact scope that I used to get on target at a mile with 6.5 Creedmoor, and it worked perfectly. I did not have to use any extra holdover in the excellent mil quad reticle inside here. All I had to do was dial, and I could get on target with this and hold off for wind. This is a brilliant scope. It has a lot of tracking, and like I mentioned, anybody that knows these knows that they track perfectly. These are going to hit that spot every single time, and these can take a beating with that 30mm tube. Some of the other qualities of this scope that make it really special include removing some of the features that you might have on some other similar scopes. Since it does not have any kind of zoom capability, where you can just kind of zoom in and out, it's missing the cam tube, which is going to reduce its weight, and it's also going to increase its tracking. So you're going to be able to get more elevation and more windage adjustment because there's just less stuff in there. This has 30 milliradians of travel up and down, left and right, and some of the ones that you see up here with a similar kind of zoom factor, they can't really do that. Some of these can, like the Falcon, the 4-18. This one has 30 up and down, left and right, but for the most part, the scopes that you see back here can't handle that because they have more in there. And the Falcon is certainly a heavier scope than this one. This is quite lightweight and could actually be decent for an offhand rifle. This isn't really bad at all. What you see that looks like a zoom ring right here, this is the parallax adjustment. So instead of having an extra knob to hang off and catch on things here on the side, or having an adjustable objective that can be pretty slow out in the field, this one has it right back here, and It turns nice and smoothly. All the mechanicals on here feel really good. They have squared this away a long time ago and they haven't had to fix really anything much. If you click this, as I spin this, I can feel it popping from spot to spot and really sticking in each of those detents correctly. It's not really gonna move around much at all if I jiggle the turret knob here. Yeah, it's just gonna lock into place correctly. As you can hear, this one doesn't really have much sound going on, but it does have a good feel to it. And this is one that you can very clearly read because instead of measuring 10 milliradians all the way around, it's gonna measure 5. So I really do, if I'm gonna take a really long shot, I do need to keep track of the graduations that we have below that turret. It's gonna expose them as it travels up and down, and I can see exactly where this is gonna go. One of the biggest reasons to look at a scope like this, yes, you have the extra travel, yes, you have the lighter weight, and you have a little bit more simplicity, but one of the biggest reasons to look at one of these is the image quality. If we assume similar glass components in here, if we have the same kind of lenses, same sizes, same quality, we're going to be able to get a better and possibly brighter image through one of these scopes, because we are missing some of the lenses that are on the inside. We are dealing with less overall. There's less chance for things to reflect away or to be dispersed. So you're going to get just a gorgeous image through a scope like this. This holds up really well with some of the very expensive scopes that we may have here on the bench. It produces a lot of resolution, a lot of detail. It produces color really well. And I think in this case, the only way that this one falls down compared to some of its much more expensive cousins here is that its smaller objective lens doesn't collect as much light as those. So as you start to get down toward dusk, it does start to fall off a little bit more. But if we were considering glass for glass, if this had maybe a 50 millimeter objective instead of the 42 that's on there, this would whoop it because there's just so much less that it's having to go through. This would outperform, in my opinion. I think that's the way that it would go. And that's how you get into some of the scopes that maybe your dad had on a squirrel rifle your grandpa had. I've used some of these 4-power or 6-power fixed scopes. This is designed for squirrels and rabbits, knocking down steel. This is something that can be used in a variety of situations. This scope is ridiculously lightweight. This is one that you can slap on your squirrel gun or your rabbit gun, your little plinker, and you're really not going to notice that it's there. It does not add much weight at all. This is a great scope for your kids. Because it is missing all of that extra stuff, because it's so short overall, it's 1-inch tube, small objective lens. This thing is just teeny tiny, very low profile, very easy to get behind, and you would not believe the image that comes through this thing. The glass is just excellent. I think a lot of people didn't quite believe me when I talked about this in the original review video, but I really suggest that you take a look through one of these if you can. Simmons put together a heck of a scope here. For all of its qualities, this little guy only costs about $65. You can get this for $75, $65. I've seen these just a little bit lower out on Amazon or Optics Planet. I'll put links down below. And this is one that I would not pass up. If you have a little 10-22 that you've wanted to turn into a plinker that maybe has a little bit more extended range than the iron sights that you had, maybe you want to get on target a little bit more precisely, this is just the sort of scope to look at. This little 4X is amazing. You might be surprised to find out, especially when you go to Cyclops Joe Ray's video channel, to see what manufacturers make fixed power scopes. We have some of these European brands, especially, that they love their fixed powers, and they will take all of the best of everything that they have come up with over a century plus of optics development. They will take the best glass in the world, the best mechanicals, and they will put together a fixed power scope that will probably blow your mind. I've never had a chance to use these myself, but the way that Joe describes them, I'm really eager to check one of these out, because if the image quality is anything like what he's talking about, it sounds like it would be something that I would want in my life. With these benefits in mind, why might you want to choose one versus the other, variable power versus fixed? I think a lot of it is going to depend on your scenario. As a varminter myself, I would really start to look seriously at one of these fixed power scopes. I'm not dealing with an animal that's going to be extremely close to me. It's not going to run up on me, and it's not going to be one that's going to be dangerous. So I don't have to worry about suddenly having to zoom way out in order to deal with a charging animal. This is one that I can just stay locked in really close on and take my shot, and everything should be fine, especially if I have, you know, kind of a higher magnification one like the 20x SWFA SS scope, and I can still see my target with that varmint rifle under there. It's not going to have so much recoil that it's going to throw everything off. That'll work fine. If I'm going out to the range to knock down steel and punch paper, again, that's a really good reason to choose one of the fixed powers. If I'm going out with a squirrel gun, a fixed 4-power or 6-power like that can work really well. It's going to be something that'll function at the real distances that I'm likely to get into. I'm not going to have a squirrel suddenly right here in front of my face, well, except on that one hunt that I did. But for the most part, I'm going to have a squirrel from 10 yards to 25 yards and even further out there, and that's going to be the typical shot that I'm going to get. So a scope like this fixed 4-power is going to be great, as I actually tested out in the real world. A variable power might be very important when you are dealing with animals that could be at a variety of distances, and maybe they are more mobile and just a bit more dynamic than kind of a stand-up target like a prairie dog. Yes, a prairie dog moves, but it's one that moves and then stops and waits for you to shoot it. It's a very accommodating little animal. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody. Make sure that you like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell down below. If you have gotten anything out of this series, please do consider sharing this playlist with your friends. They might get something out of it. You might have a friend that's looking for that perfect scope, doesn't quite know where to look. This might start leading them in the right direction. As usual, if you have any comments or questions about the topic at hand, please leave them in the comments section down below. I do try to monitor these pretty much all the time, and if I can actually see one come through, a lot of the time I'll try to answer it. And then there are lots of folks out here watching these videos that know more than I do and can answer some of those questions directly. Thanks a lot, you guys that actually are chiming in when people come in with some particular questions about things that maybe I've never touched before. Thank you to patrons of the Destructive Arts for making videos like these possible. If anybody else would like to join them to make more videos like these happen, then I'll put a link to Patreon. At the $338 Lapua Magnum level, we have Sportsman's Guide, Stan and Mary and Tyler. And at the 300 Win Mag level, we have Joseph Davis, Peter, Mr. No Name, and Howard. And we have a lot of other folks chipping in a buck or two a month to help keep videos like these coming. I'll see you all around. Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to like, share, and most importantly, subscribe. Even if you didn't like this particular content, go ahead and subscribe. There's probably something coming that's more up your alley. Check out this playlist right here. This is going to have videos in a similar vein to what you just watched. These two videos we cherry-picked for you. And finally, The Social Regressive is on Patreon. So, you can become a patron of the Destructive Arts and earn some goodies while helping us to provide high-quality videos just by kicking us a few bucks a month. Thanks so much for your patronage.